بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Lateral approach to the hip. The lateral approach to the hip is well known all over the world by Harding or modification of Harding as Bauer approach. All these approaches uses anterior dislocation to attack anterior part of the hip or to do a hip replacement surgery by entering the hip through the lateral side. So it's a muscle cutting incision in which you cut part of the gluteus muscle to enter the hip. The patient should be placed in a dead lateral position because this will delineate your orientation during the replacement surgery. Usually the surgeon stands behind the patient with an assistant beside him, assistant in front of him, and the nurse in front of him. We supported the cadaver by a sandbag in front and a sandbag behind, and putting the limb in a proper or a dead lateral position. This approach is usually centered on the hip or the acetabulum. The patient usually lies in the dead lateral position, as we said. The lower limb should lie in line with his trunk and his chest. The bony landmarks and the skin incision, the greater trochanter, the mid-diaphyseal axis of the shaft of the femur, the anterior superior iliac spine, and a line dropping vertical from the anterior superior iliac spine to the line connecting the mid-diaphyseal axis of the shaft. This line, usually the midpoint between it and the greater trochanter, is our start of the incision. Of course, the incision varies according to the position of the greater trochanter in relationship to the acetabulum, but usually this is the standard incision. We start with sharp dissection along this line for the skin subcutaneous until reaching the superficial fascia or the fascia lata lying at the lateral part of the incision. Once you expose the fascia lata distally or covering the vastus lateralis, you should expose the fascia covering the tensor fascia lata anteriorly and the fascia covering the gluteus posteriorly. So we start by sharp dissection distally, and then you pass your finger below the fascia lata to feel the muscle fibers of the tensor fascia lata inserted at the anterior border of the fascia lata anteriorly, and the fibers of the gluteus maximus inserted at the posterior border of the fascia lata posteriorly. And we should go between the muscle fibers in a bloodless field. This is very important, so as not to injure the muscle as well as to reduce the bleeding inside the operation. This incision should usually start vertical distal and slightly and curves slightly anterior proximally. Once you expose the fascia, this is the muscle fibers of the tensor fascia lata inserted at the anterior border of the fascia lata, and this is the muscle fibers of the gluteus maximus inserted at the posterior border of the fascia lata. Once you reach the bursa, We usually incise the bursa, or sometimes if it contains blood, like hemorrhagic bursitis, it's preferred to excise it so as to not to prevent adhesions postoperative. And once you expose the proximal femur, you have to identify the anatomy. This is the vastus lateralis, inserted at the upper part of the at the lower border of the greater trochanter, and this is the gluteus medius muscle. The gluteus medius muscle has two parts of fibers. The anterior part is the flexor group, and the superior part is the abductor group. It's inserted in the lateral border of the greater trochanter in a V-shaped incision together with the gluteus minimus. This is the flexor group, and the upper part is the abductor group. So it has a fan-shaped muscle pattern with an anterior and a superior insertion. Now we dissect bluntly below the inferior border, allowing us to separate its inferior border from the underlying structures. This is how I separate the flexor fibers, and the flexor fibers end at the tip of the greater trochanter. So this is the flexor fibers. It ends at the tip of the greater trochanters, and then comes upwards the abductor fibers. So what we do to enter the hip, that we cut sharply from the tendineous part from the greater trochanter until we reach the upper part of the flexor fibers, and we should not injure the lesser the abductor fibers. The superior gluteal nerve comes from the greater sciatic notch, and it runs about 3 to 5 centimeters above the level of the greater trochanter, and this is very variable. So what we don't want to do is that we curve straight upwards so as not to prevent the superior gluteal nerve. So what we will do now is that we will incise one facial and muscle incision, separating the vastus lateralis and then reaching the greater trochanter, the tip of the greater trochanter, curving along the muscle fibers towards the anterior superior iliac spine. We don't need much than this of muscle cutting to clearly or to see the joint. Sharp dissection along the muscle fibers, and then you reach the gluteus minimus muscle just lying below the gluteus maximus, and then sharp dissection separating it from the underlying capsule. So this is the abductor fibers of the gluteus medius, and this is the gluteus minimus, and this is the lower part. So I prefer to incise it in line with the vastus lateralis so as to have a good muscle sheet for repair, good repair at the end of the operation. Once I incise, sharply separate these muscle fibers from its insertion in the bone, I start putting a homen at the inferior part of the incision. That's how it looks, the muscle sheet intraoperative, separating part of the vastus lateralis and then going from the tip of the greater trochanter towards the anterior superior iliac spine with the muscle fibers. So if we look at the nerve as well as the muscle, we are sparing all the abductor part of the muscle, as well as not injuring, or there is no possibility of injuring, the superior gluteal nerve by doing this curved incision. I put a homen at the inferior part of the incision, another homen on the neck, and then we do the capsulotomy. These homens are placed extracapsular, separating the muscle from the capsule, finally opening the capsule or excising the capsule. Usually in doing hemiarthroplasties, I open the capsule in a T-shaped incision, straight incision along the acetabulum, and then a lower and an upper limb along the femoral component so as to be able to repair the capsule, increasing the stability. That's in hemiarthroplasties. In total hip replacements, I prefer to excise the capsule for a better exposure of the acetabul. Placing the human. So this cadaver has a fractured neck of femur or an osteotomized neck. So after removal of the head and neck and exposure of the acetabulum. Exposure of the acetabulum depends on putting the limb in a proper position as well as putting the humans in a special pattern. So that's the transverse acetabular ligament. That's the superior part or the dome of the acetabulum towards the head of the patient. We usually put a human at the anterior or the 3 o'clock position. So I sharply dissect the labrum from the capsule or the intercapsular labral recess, and then I place a sharp human at the anterior or 3 o'clock position, retracting the iliopsoas muscle and all the anterior hip structures. Then placing a human or a double curved or a cobra human at the posteroinferior part of the capsule. That also is placed intracapsular but outside the labrum, so in the capsule labral recess. So this human retracts the femur posteriorly, allowing me to see clearly the posterior part of the joint or the posterior wall, so as not to miss a proper reaming direction. And finally, I place a human at the superior part of the joint, and sometimes I hammer this human in the superior wall if it is strong enough to occupy it. So that's an intraoperative photo of how it looks. You can see clearly. And then I usually change position. I come in front of the patient so as to have a very good view of the acetabulum, and I start reaming from the other direction. Instead of standing behind the patient, I stand in front of the patient, ream the acetabulum, put my cup in a proper orientation. For a femoral exposure, we usually place a human behind the proximal femur. It lies between the fascia lata and the gluteus medius tendon. This human is placed in the soft tissue. Again, you levate the fascia lata, and this human encircles or hug the femur, pushing it upwards. The position of dislocation is flexion, adduction, and external rotation. Once you lower the knee and you put the human to push the femur upwards, that provide you with a proper exposure. Once you rotate the femur, I put a human below the lesser trochanter to expose the shaft clearly and to see the shaft for proper alignment of the prothesis beside the human placed on the greater trochanter. This is the position of dislocation. The assistant usually perform traction, adduction, and external rotation, and the femur comes up while I am placing a human behind the greater trochanter and pushing the proximal femur upwards. This is how it looks, and you should drape the other side with a bag so as to prevent the lower limb from losing its sterilization. So the position of reduction after doing a total hip is the vice versa. First we do an extension of the limb, extend the limb, traction, and finally simple internal rotation should reduce the limb easily. So we finally extend the limb, and then traction and simple internal rotation should reduce the limb. You should not be aggressive during dislocation or reduction to prevent any fractures in the distal part of the lower limb. So that's the position of dislocation, and that's the position of relocation. It's a very simple approach in which you should incise or detach only a small part of the gluteus muscle, and this part should be properly repaired. Usually I use an absorbable sutures, except in very rare situation, I use a non-absorbable sutures, but usually we use absorbable sutures. We start suturing the vastus lateralis distally, the angle, and then the horizontal limb of the L with the muscles in a loose type of sutures. Special thanks to Elixir Pharma for sponsoring this scientific work.